Hello. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Shir Gal Kochavi, and I'm here to start our Zooming in today with Francesco Spagnolo. We're going to let people
trickle in.
Hi, Francesco. It's wonderful to see you.
Yeah. We're going to wait just a few seconds to let people trickle in and join us.
Yep. I'll take advantage of this minute that we have to thank our colleague, Ross Calter, who's helping us in managing these
Ross
Zoom
sessions. Ross is helping
us from
behind the scenes.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So thank you.
You're doing a great job. So thank you, Ross.
And I think we could get started. I think it's probably time to get going.
Excellent.
About half an hour together with our audience today.
So welcome, everyone. This is Zooming In, our weekly curatorial conversations from the Magnes Collection of Jewish Art and Life. My name is Shir Gal Kochavi, and I'm assistant curator at the Magnes. And joining me is Francesco Spagnolo, our fearless curator. Today we are having a Zoom session, which means that all participants have their cameras off, but you can all interact with us in two ways. On the bottom of your screens, you have the Q&A button to ask us if you want to ask us any questions, or if you have any technical difficulties, or want to just share with us thoughts or the place where you're Zooming in with us today, please use the chat button on the bottom of your screen. Just as a reminder, the Magnes Collection is one of the three largest Jewish museum collections in the United States, and one of the largest Jewish museum collections in the world. It is the only Jewish museum associated with a major research university, University of California, Berkeley. And today we are going to discuss a very interesting topic that we mentioned in this series not a little while ago, but today we're looking at it from a very different angle. So Francesco, allow me to invite you.
Yes, our title today is Birth Certificates in Cloth, Ritual Textiles for the Jewish Life Cycle. And as you were saying, a few weeks ago, we had a colleague from the Boston Museum of Fine Arts joining us and discussing various synagogue textiles. And we started mentioning the topic that we're dealing with today, which is very, very specific kind of ritual textile. And in some ways, the ritual textiles that's made of different ritual objects all at once. So we're going to unpack quite literally textiles made. This is actually the one that our colleague from Boston brought to our attention.
Yes.
So these are specific ritual textiles that are a custom of Southern Germany, the historical custom of Southern Germany. They go back several centuries, and they followed Southern German Jews wherever they moved. So we find them from Southern Germany, Alsace, but also Denmark, and sometimes even the United States. I've heard of these textiles being produced to this day by descendants of German Jewish immigrants in the United States. But these textiles are many things, as I was saying, many things at once. They are, first of all, cloths for the ritual circumcision. They're also used as Torah binders, but they're, as we will see, we'll explore, they're birth certificates and in a way, communal records. They hold records of communal significance, and as we will discuss, that allows to actually reconstruct personal histories and communal history in very interesting ways. Mm-hmm. And to wrap everything, since they're used for wrapping, they are also for the life cycle. So they're designed to accompany a newborn boy. These are only made for
boys.
Male children. Mm-hmm. They're designed, and let's look at them a little bit together. This the Magnes has many in its collection. They're designed to accompany an individual from birth until maturity, old age. And so they start as cloths for the circumcision to swaddle a baby during their ritual circumcision ceremony. And then these cloths are cut and stitched together into a long textile. And hence we just mostly show details, because showing a whole one is, as you will see, we will see together, is a bit problematic because they're very, very long. And they are inscribed and illustrated, presented with the child when the child turns one, presented to the community along with the child, and then will be used as Torah binders to wrap the Torah, the scrolls of the Hebrew Bible during services on the Shabbat, connected with the young person's bar mitzvah, then wedding, and then just in throughout their lives and important occasions. But as you will see, they're also framed by text that's amuletic in nature, and that so they're in a way designed to not just accompany but also protect a newborn throughout their lives. So let's start with the ritual circumcision. And we are going to see how at each stage the same textile becomes something else, and but it's all packed into one long textile object. So ritual circumcision is a topic that's very much dealt with in Jewish collections around the world, right, Shir?
Mm-hmm,
and these are a couple of examples of materials of objects from the Magnes collection that
reflect
the ritual circumcision.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have a pillow to hold the child. So that's from Vienna. So in Vienna, they were not using cloths to swaddle and doing that, even though it was not too far away from Bavaria and southern Germany and Alsace. And on the right, we have a set of circumcision objects from the very scary, at least for some of us, knife, a very sharp knife and clamp, to the cups to hold the wine for the blessings, a prayer book, a sharpening stone, ointment, and other materials to stop the bleeding, and so on. These are objects that belong to Mohel, so a ritual circumciser. If I understand correctly, Shir, there was kind of like a rush among collectors, late 19th, early 20th, to secure at least one set in mm-hmm. every collection. And I think you documented this from other collections from the Magnes mm-hmm. that have actual sets with cases. So do you want to tell us about these?
Yeah, these are two beautiful examples, one from the UK, from Exeter, 18th century Exeter, and another one from 19th century Netherlands. And the one from the Netherlands is actually currently living at the Jewish Museum in New York. And they're, and what's unique about these collections, these objects, is that it's the full set of items that originally belonged to a specific mohel or a specific community, and were used to perform these ritual circumcision. Century to and of course 20th century to actually be able to find and collect an item that had all the ritual objects that were part of the circumcision ceremony, and to fit and to find also the box where they belong to. So these two are really unique examples, I think, and very obviously very valuable ones.
You know, help me out here, Shir, with your knowledge of Jewish museum collections worldwide, but it seems to me that there was also like an agenda in this rush in collecting these sets, which had to do more with an ethnographic attempt on the part of collectors. And I suspect collecting items for a ritual that, especially in the early 20th century, was felt in Europe to be a legacy of the past. Ritual circumcision, especially in Germany mm-hmm. and German lands, was really not practiced that widely by Jews by then. And so it was really like collecting the sects, if I understand well, really mm-hmm. meant collecting an item from a past that was not going to repeat itself into the present or future.
Right? Exactly, almost like collecting an heirloom that will only be displayed from now onwards, and it was once used to perform something holy. But really for the sake of the future generations.
And as we were saying, and this is one of the most beautiful, most visually enticing objects, ritual textiles from the Magnes collection, is the other element of the ritual circumcision ceremony, as we were saying, was this cloth that would be used to swaddle a baby and then would be repurposed in all kinds of ways. We were saying that it's difficult to display them in one slide because they're very, very long, even to photograph mm-hmm. them.
All yeah, so this one is long. Compacted.
It's a beautiful photo. Yeah. Yeah. It's like sort of a redux a version of a very long textile. This was created, it was a gift of the Lilienthal family in San Francisco, but it was made for, well, we'll explore it later, but it was made most likely for Max Lilienthal, who then became a very important, made in Germany, but it became a very important rabbi in the United States, and that spread the reform movement around the South and West of the United States in the 19th century. But so we'll get back to that. And each of these textiles is full of text and details.
And surprises.
This one is special because it has also, and we see it on the left, right?
Exactly.
It has the signature of the maker. So we know who made it.
Yes, which we rarely or almost never see on these textiles.
It was a gentleman named Koppel and Moses Heller Siegel that made it. And on the right, we see the beginning of the text, we see the name of the child.
Mm-hmm.
The issue of display is an issue that haunts anyone who has confronted these textiles. So it's interesting that in this, early 18th century book that we've used in the past, it's an incredible resource of visual culture, visual representation of Jewish rituals from the 18th century and 19th century Germany. We see how the graphics, this is on the right side of the screen, we have one of these vimpelis, these Torah binders and circumcision cloth, is displayed similar to how our colleagues at the Museum of Fine Arts photograph them. So not as a in their length, but going around. But if one has to read it this way, one has to start here, then you have to turn your head around, go around like this. It's a bit complicated to read the text. So we also, I think, try to make it a little easier to read. So above is the Hebrew, and sure, you can do the honors of reading. So this is a template of what would be inscribed on a vimpel, on this type of cloth, right?
Yeah. So I'll start and then you'll translate for everyone. Yeah. Ploni, Ben, or Ben Rabbi, Almoni, Hamechune, XY for his name, En, Nun, for Nolad, Be, Mazal Tov, Beyom, with the full date and the year, the Jewish year, Igdal, Ba, or sometimes we use La, Torah, Vela Chupa, Ulema Simtovim, Amen Sela.
So, and this roughly translates as X. We use the Hebrew, the Talmudic Hebrew, Ploni Almoni, for saying John Doe. So, X son of Y. Sometimes the inscription includes the secular name, not just the Hebrew name. So, Abraham, son of, etc., but a secular name. Born, and there is a formula, under a good constellation, the Mazal Tov, on, and there is a specific date in the Hebrew calendar, so day, month, a year, and then good wishes. May he grow to Torah, meaning to the age of Bar Mitzvah, to Chuppah, as the wedding canopy, so to maybe get married, and to good deeds, meaning achieve maturity and wealth, in a way. And then there is another closing, which is a quotation from the Book of Psalms. Several psalms include this formula, Amen, Selah. So we're going step by step through all of these elements and really trying to understand how they work. The first thing, after these textiles were used as circumcision cloths and then inscribed with all of these elements that we just saw, is that they were presented together with the child when the child turned one to the congregation and used as Torah binders. Can you guide us through that, Shir?
Of course. And Torah binders were, of course, used, as we'll see momentarily, to hold the closed Torah very tightly. These are two examples that we selected from a beautifully illustrated 17th century book created by Paul Christian Kirchner. And on the left side, you actually see a depiction of the night before the bris. So you see the circumcision. Very, very Israeli mistake of me, by me. The night before the circumcision, where you see the room of the mother and the child, and you see the people coming and reciting the prayers for protection, reciting the names of the angels, Sanui, Samsanui, and Samangelaf, were the three angels who traditionally protect the newborn and his mother in the first days after the birth from the evil Lilith. which we discussed in the past. And then on the right side, you actually see the ceremony of the circumcision held in the synagogue. And on the right side, on the bottom of that image, you see the seat, and on that seat is the godfather who's holding the baby. And next to him is the mohel. So, so these are really beautiful, very traditional depictions of the ceremony and the night before. And then of course we have the binders. So these, as Francesco said just a moment ago, were used as a swaddle cloth for the baby. And then they were cut and they were decorated and colored and painted with the name, date, etc., which we'll discuss in a moment. But essentially this is also an object that becomes, that kind of transitions very quickly from a private object that belongs to a baby and was used in a very private circumstances in the house into a to an object that's really used, that has a social role, that's being displayed, a display of an identity of a family in a community. And this is just another beautiful example of this cloth. And you see that the end rope there at the end that assists in binding, which not all of these have, that not all of these have survived. And this is an example from the Israel Museum. This is actually a Torah binder from Rome, from Italy. Probably from 17th century, but beyond that, I think we should look at this not only as a form of identity for the child, for the family, but also as a way that sometimes, as we looked at in the past, the mother or the grandmother would create this for the child and then display it and for the community to see. So again, a form of movement, an object that moves between public and in display. But let's look at it also in the sense of the birth certificate and the additional significance that it has.
So the inscriptions on these Torah binders, now they've become Torah binders, include very specific biographical details. We highlight them, essentially name, patronymic, sometimes a secular first and last name, and an exact birth date. So we can leverage this information, and this information in a way becomes a sort of a record of births in a synagogue. And since these most often these textiles will be kept in stored in synagogues, they and be pulled out on the right occasion to be used for the throughout the life cycle of a person, they collectively constitute the communal records. Unfortunately, many of these textiles were kept in synagogues that were burned during Kristallnacht in 1938 by the Nazis, and many are lost. There are about 200 of them in the Magnes collection. Many of them were collected by Siegfried Strauss before World War II and removed from Europe in the 1930s and brought to the United States after that. Here is the case of the one we've been looking at, and it's a one which was created, at least per the family records, he was an infant at the time in this painting. The family also donated to the Magnes this wonderful painting for the Lilienthal family and for Max Lilienthal. As I was saying, Max Lilienthal became an influential rabbi, especially in the United States. He was educated in Germany, lived in the United States, etc. However, if we look at the various historical records, including family books but encyclopedia entries and articles about Max Lilienthal, we find the date of October 16, 1814. And on this textile, the date translates the Hebrew date, which is here. I'm going to highlight it with my pointer here. This Hebrew date translates into November 6, 1815. So sometimes these birth records, birth certificates of sorts, can cause problems, but other times we can really leverage them to identify individuals. For example, this one, when here we have a beautiful picture of the whole thing, we had to digitally restitch it together. It can be only photographed in sections to be displayed this way. But we have here the Hebrew name, and then we also have the secular name of the baby for whom this was created. And his name was Emmanuel Gantz. And we know what date he was born. So we did some research, right, Shir? Do you wanna share what kind of research we did and what did we find about Mr. Emmanuel Gantz?
Yeah, we were very lucky.
In 1867.
Exactly, we're very lucky because we have his Hebrew name, we have his father's first name, and we also have, of course, his foreign name. And and the date of birth. With all that information, we're able to search for the name and the date, of course, in different databases. And eventually we are able to find out a quite a sad ending that that Emmanuel Gans had. And we identified him in the Ghetto Theresienstadt list that belongs today to the National Archives in Prague, and found out through several additional archival work that goes through, of course, the Yad Vashem archives in Jerusalem, et cetera, that he was one of 100 people who were sent from Berlin to Theresienstadt in August 1942. And he actually died in Theresienstadt at the ghetto just a month later, at the beginning
shortly
of September.
Shortly after that, yeah.
Mm-hmm, shortly after his arrival. He was, I think, over 70 years old. But if I'm not mistaken, by the calculation of his age, and it says that he died from a heart failure. But I imagine that beyond that is what we all know about.
These are the Nazi records.
Exactly, what we know about the Theresienstadt ghetto, we'll never
of the concentration know what happened. And the records are maintained by the National Archives in Prague. So we also reached out to the National Archives in Prague to confirm this data, and we're pretty confident that for this specific case, the birth certificate in cloth and the death certificate on paper match, and we're talking about the same individual. So in other words, these textiles can really serve as historical records.
Absolutely.
But they're also something else. And with this topic, we kind of close our presentation. Right. And remind everybody that there is a Q&A button at the bottom of everybody's screen. So if anybody has any questions, please ask away. But as we were illustrated earlier, these cloths are also amulets, and they follow the life cycle of an individual. So again, they have this formula in Hebrew, bet memtet be mazal tov, under a good mazal tov means a good constellation. So basically, sometimes that's really expressed into a sign of the zodiac. So it has an astrological value, and they follow the life cycle by mentioning Torah, chuppah, and good deeds, and then eventually close with another amuletic formula from the Book of Psalms, Amen Selah. Yes. So let's look at all of these. And Shir, I was asked in chat to speak a little closer to the microphone, so I'm holding the microphone closer to my mind. That's why I'm looking a little funny today doing this, but I want to make sure that people from home can hear me. So here we have Bemazaltov, an acronym. Mm-hmm. Under a good star, the life cycle, the mention of the three aspects of the life cycle, and then the closing formula, Amen Selah. In a way, the whole inscription is an amulet.
Yes.
And it's a personal amulet. It's inscribed with a name, so it's supposed to protect a very specific person.
Individual. Mm-hmm.
And oftentimes, as we will see, the various parts of moments of the life cycle are illustrated with images that are either embroidered or painted on these textiles. So let's just take a look. Again, we're back to the vigil before the circumcision, a very, very scary time in which, as you were saying, babies can be prey of all kinds of evil spirits. What was interesting for me looking at this depiction is how these are the names of the protecting angels, but they're inscribed on a cloth that looks very much like a vimple, mm-hmm. like one of the cloths we're dealing with. So the theme seems to almost predate the circumcision by a few hours and follow the life of a person, and in a way belongs to the general topic of amulets that are designed to protect a baby and then to protect a person in life. Mm-hmm. We have discussed amulets at the very beginning of our series. It was, we're now at whatever, we've presented about 15 of these talks, 14, 15 of these talks. We have two more before we close for the winter. And we started very much with amulets and the idea that they're sort of representing a form of health insurance, a pre-modern health insurance. And so these are some of the examples we examined then. Here
but
it is.
These all are concentrate on protection of a child and the mother after giving birth, just to get us back into the mazal tov.
Yeah, so mazal tov is here. These are the acronyms, and also we like how the word born here, I'm circling, has a stork, whereas the mazal tov and the day of birth on this other textile is marked also by the zodiac sign, right? Scorpio.
Yes, the Scorpio.
or in Hebrew, mazal akav, right? And so the mazal tov is there, and it's part of the formula. And so is the mention of Torah, as in bar mitzvah, often illustrated, in this case, with the depiction on the bottom right of the Torah scrolls, and on the left of the actual elevation of the Torah, the Agba'ah ritual,
and
the bar mitzvah boy, we assume. We don't see the boy's face, but he's hidden behind the scroll, but it's an entire depiction of the actual act of becoming bar mitzvah and reading from the Torah scroll. Then there is the chuppah, Shir.
Yeah, the depictions of the chuppah really vary. It's quite interesting to look at them. On the one hand, we have, in these two examples, we have the chuppah, of course, with the cups of wine and the people who are holding the chuppah, and of course the rabbi in the center on the image on the left, and then on the bottom we have more of a modern chuppah where the bride and groom are dressed in quite modern 19th century clothing. But we also have other examples in our collection where you really just see the chuppah canopy, or you just see a floral decoration that reminds us of, you know, of the celebration, and of course how we celebrate the chuppah occasionally.
So these illustrations are almost like snapshots of customs, different times in history. We see the change in what the characters are wearing. I'm very fond of course, the fact that there is also a violin player. There's a musician, some kind of klezmer. Yeah, some kind of klezmer as part of the wedding ceremony here. And then ma'asim tovim, good deeds. They're represented sometimes with nothing. They just have reference. And sometimes we see that there are kinds of actions that more or less indicate wealth. Mm-hmm. But the idea is reaching maturity and wealth. By the way, I suspect that here we also have a little Zionist flag.
Yes, that could very well be.
It's 1922. It's a late textile, and some of these have also elements of national identity, Zionism. They're personalized in all kinds of ways, but the general formula is always there, because they have to conform to a standard. And in fact, as we were saying, they close with the expression Amen Sela. As we were saying, this is found in the Book of Psalms. Mm-hmm.
And here we also have the German flag from the same Torah binder that also had in the beginning of it the Zionist reference of the flag, the blue and white flag, and then at the end, of course, the very specific German identity that they would not let go.
So these are very interesting materials, and we of course encourage questions, use of chat. We just have maybe 1 minute left in our broadcast, so if anybody has any questions about what we presented, please shoot them. But essentially, what we do is we, as you can see, we take photos, we examine the visual elements, but also the data, so that we can understand more about the individual. Individuals that are represented, and so we can use them to reconstruct history. I suspect that there is one question. So
yes.
If you want to, I can't read it.
I'll be responsible for questions today, and I really appreciate this question, because if I can just preview it with a sentence, it's lovely to see how today the custom of creating these Torah binders is being reestablished and restarted, and they're created for girls as well, and I wish I had one. And so our first question is, how much time would it take to produce one of these cloths? Good question. Since none of us actually created one ourselves, I would say that it really depends on the amount of work that you invest and the type of way that you decide to create the cloth, whether you choose to use paint or you choose to embroider. I think it really depends on the artist, the individual work that they decide to invest in the creation of that piece.
Some of these are very rudimental, and we expect that it didn't take too much to create, whether others are really precious, embellished in all kinds of ways. And we saw one that was created by a commission to some kind of embroidery artist.
Mm-hmm. And somebody actually already commented that it took them 2 months to embroider.
There you go.
So there you go.
We have more questions, I think, right? I only see the bubble that says we have questions, but I can't read them. So
yes, we do have a few comments. And thank you, everybody who's listening to us today, of just thanking us and saying that this was a glorious presentation and that they enjoyed it tremendously. And people who ask if it was embroidered by family members.
Sometimes yes, and sometimes no. And we saw a little bit of both cases, probably. Also, the materials used and the type of embroidery indicates the family's social status and wealth. Wealthier families sometimes would have much more flashy binders than others, right? Mm-hmm. So yes. From that standpoint, they're also indicators of social status, and they can be studied as historical records in all kinds of ways.
Yeah, but let's take a moment to maybe thank you all and also tell you a little bit about our talk next week, which you all will hopefully be able to join us for. We're going to be talking about displaying identity, protecting oneself. What do we learn from the shape of Chanukah lamps? And this is one of two talks about surrounding Chanukah and Chanukah lamps that are going to be, we promise you, significantly different from one another. And we hope you can join us to explore what we learn and how we see and how we interpret shapes of Chanukah lamps.
And let me also add that the JCCs, the Jewish Community Centers of the Bay Area, have decided to join us in this effort and to co-sponsor by promoting our talks in the next couple of weeks, so that hopefully even more people will be able to join us when we present. And as you were saying, we'll be discussing, to begin with, the shape of Hanukkah lamps, and we can learn, just as we learned from the inscriptions and on Torah binders, we can learn all kinds of interesting details about history, culture, behaviors, ideas, hopes, and whatnot around the ubiquitous lamp for the Hanukkah festival. And then we'll look at the end of our series, that will be our last talk, about a Hanukkah lamp of hope, a signal of hope and rebirth that was created in a camp for displaced persons in Germany right after World War II, at the very end of World War II, 1945.
Yes.
So this was our talk for today. I don't know do we have any more questions?
I think we're really grateful
to everyone for following us. And we're not going to wish anyone Happy Hanukkah yet, because it's not yet there, but we will do that together with
next week.
Next week, next Friday. And looking forward to seeing you again next Friday, Shir.
Yeah, see you then. And have a nice weekend, everybody. Bye.
Thank you. Bye. Bye.